Hello, this is Professor Hosselman, and this is History 105, and today we're going to be talking about the roots and birth of the Protestant Reformation in Europe, which is what we'll be talking about this week in class. So let's begin here. We're going to talk about these reformations. Now, the roots of the Reformation lie... hold on a second while it's loading. Okay. Here we go. Now, the roots of the Reformation lie far back in the Middle Ages, the High Middle Ages, with the rise of towns and even a money economy. Now, this led to four lines of development that all converged in the Reformation. First, a money economy led to the rise of kings who clashed with the popes over control of church taxes. And one of these clashes that between Pope Boniface VIII and Philip IV of France triggered the Babylonian captivity and the Great Schism. So that's the first. Second, the replacement of a land-based economy with a money economy led to growing numbers of abuses by the church and its desperation for cash. And both of these factors, both the rise of kings and the death of a land-based economy, seriously damaged the church's reputation and helped lead to the Lollard and Hussite heresies, which would heavily influence Luther's Protestant Reformation. Now, another effect of the rise of towns was a more plentiful supply of money with which humanists could patronize Renaissance culture. Now, when the Renaissance reached Northern Europe, the idea of studying the Bible in the original Greek and Hebrew fused with the North's greater emphasis on religion, which we talked about last time, thus paving the way for a biblical scholar such as Martin Luther to challenge the church. So that's the first three. And finally, towns and trade spread new ideas and technology. And several of these bits of technology, some from as far away as China, helped lead to the invention of the printing press, which helped the Reformation in two ways. It made books cheaper, which let Luther have his own copy of the Bible, and the chance to find what he saw as flaws in the church's thinking. And second, the printing press would spread Luther's ideas much more quickly and further afield than earlier heretical printings tried to without the printing press. Now, all these factors, growing dissatisfaction with corruption and scandal in the church, religious emphasis of the Northern Renaissance, and the printing press contributed to create a growing interest in biblical scholarship. Nowhere was this interest more volatile or dangerous than in Germany. And the main reason for this was the fragmentation of Germany into over 300 states, which helped the Reformation in a few ways. For one thing, there was no one power to stop the large number of church abuses afflicting Germany, thus breeding a great deal of anger in Germany against the church. And for another thing, the lack of central control also made it very difficult to stop the spread of any new ideas. This was especially true in Germany, with over 30 printing presses, few if any being under tight centralized control, and each of which was capable of quickly churning out literally thousands of copies of Protestant books and pamphlets. Now, if Germany could be seen as a tinderbox, just waiting to spark to set it aflame, Martin Luther was that spark. Now, Luther, as his picture shows here, like all great men who shape history, was also a product of his own age. Luther had a strict religious upbringing, especially from his father, who frequently beat his son for the slightest mistakes. School was little better. Martin Luther was repeatedly beaten 15 times in one day for misdeclining a noun. And all this created a tremendous sense of guilt and sinfulness in him and influenced his view of God as a harsh and terrifying being. Therefore, Luther's reaction to the view of God as a harsh and terrifying being, above already mentioned, reaction to a thunderstorm in 1506 should come as no surprise. He carried out his vow and joined a monastic order. Now, as a monk, Luther carried his religious sense of guilt to self-destructive extremes, describing how he almost tortured himself to death through praying, reading, and even vigils. Now, indeed, one morning, his fellow monks came into his cell to find him lying senseless on the ground, and given the situation, something had to give. either Luther's body or his concept of Christianity. His body survived. Now, out of concern for Martin Luther, for his fellow monks, thanks to the printing press, gave him a copy of the Bible, where Luther found two passages that would change his life and history. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast, which is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 9, and also Romans chapter 3, verse 28. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. And as Luther put it, thereupon I felt as if I had been born again and had entered paradise through a wide open gates. Immediately the whole of Scripture took on a new meaning for me. I raced through the Scriptures so far as my memory went and found analogies and other expressions. And from this, Luther concluded that faith is a free gift of God, and that no amount of praying, good deeds, or self-abuse could affect one's salvation. Only faith could do that. Now, in the following years, Luther's ideas quietly matured as he pursued a career as a professor. Now, back then, a church position. Then, in 1517, trouble erupted. Pope Leo X, desperate for money to complete the magnificent St. Peter's Cathedral in Rome, authorized the sale of indulgences. These were documents issued by the church that supposedly relieved their owners of time in purgatory, a place where Catholics believe they must purge themselves of their sins before going to heaven. Now, originally, indulgences had been granted to crusaders for their efforts for the faith, and in time they were sold to any of the faithful who wanted them. The idea was that the money paid was the result of one's hard work and was sanctified by being donated to the church. However, it was easily subject to abuse as a convenient way to raise money. Now, indulgence sales were especially profitable in Germany, where there was no strong central government to stop the church from taking money out of the country. Now, this greatly angered many Germans and made them more ready to listen to criticism of the church when it came. Now, the church's agent for selling indulgences in Brandenburg in northern Germany, John Tetzel, used some highly questionable methods. He reportedly told local priests that these indulgences would relieve them of the guilt for sins they wished to commit in the future, and that, after buying them, the surrounding hills would turn to silver. Now, he even had a little jingle, much like a commercial. As soon as a coin and coffer rings, a soul from purgatory springs. Now, Luther was then a professor in nearby Wittenberg, Saxony, not far from the home of the Hussite heresy in Bohemia. Now, when some local people showed him the indulgences they had bought, he denied they were valid. Tetzel denounced Luther for this, and Luther took up the challenge. On October 31st, 1517, Luther nailed a placard to the church door in Wittenberg. On it were the 95 theses, or statements, criticizing various church practices, some of which are given here. Now, it's important to remember that Martin Luther knew that October the 31st, 1517, was going to be a very important day. Now, October the 31st is a day we celebrate here in the United States, is Halloween. Also known as All Hallows Eve. And the day after is the Day of the Dead, and following that is All Souls Day, November the 1st and November the 2nd. Now, in Catholic tradition, these are holy days of obligation, where church members are required to come to church at least these days, if not any of the other days. And these include other days such as Easter and Christmas and other days of holy days of obligation. So Luther specifically knew that if he posted this on October the 31st, he would get a large viewing from people that were required by their faith to come to the church for services. Now, if you take some time to look through these 95 theses, you will find some interesting things that Martin Luther was upset with. There's obviously just here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8 of them. There were 95 in total. Basically, 95 arguments of why Luther was upset with the problems in the church. Now, Luther's purpose was not to break away from the church, but merely to stimulate debate, a time-honored academic tradition. The result, however, was a full-scale religious transformation that would destroy Europe's religious unity forever. Now, soon, copies of Luther's 95 Theses were printed and spread all over Germany, where they found a very receptive audience. Indulgence sales plummeted, and the authorities in Rome were soon concerned about this obscure professor from Wittenberg. Papal legates were sent to talk sense into Luther, and at first he was open to reconciliation with the church, but more and more he found himself defying the church. Now, Luther's own rhetoric against the church was becoming much more radical. Now, according to Martin Luther, if Rome thus believes and teaches with the knowledge of popes and cardinals, which I hope is not the case, then in these writings I freely declare that the true Antichrist is sitting in the temple of God and is reigning in Rome, that unpurpled Babylon, and that the Roman church is a synagogue of Satan. And if we strike thieves with the gallows, robbers with the sword, heretics with fire, why do we not much more attack in arms these masters of perdition, these cardinals, these popes, and all the sink of the Roman Sodom, which has without end corrupted the church of God and washed her hands in their blood? Oh, that God from heaven would soon destroy thy throne and sink it in the abyss of hell. O Christ, my Lord, look down, let the day of thy judgment break and destroy the devil's nest at Rome. Now, Luther also realized how to exploit the issue of the Italian church draining money from Germany. Some have estimated, according to Martin Luther, that every year more than 300,000 gulden find their way from Germany to Italy. We here come to the heart of that matter. How comes it that we Germans must put up with such robbery and such extortion of our property at the hands of the Pope? If we justly hand thieves and behead robbers, why should we let Roman avarice go free? For he is the greatest thief and robber that has come or can come into the world, in all the holy name of Christ and Saint Peter. Who can longer endure it or keep silence? Now, the papal envoy, Alexander, described the anti-Catholic climate in Germany after Martin Luther pronounced his new religion. Or his new break with the church, or not, he hadn't broken with the church yet, but his demand for changes in the church. All Germany is up in arms against Rome, said the papal envoy. All the world is clamoring for a council that shall meet on German soil. Papal bulls of excommunication are laughed at. Numbers of people have ceased to receive the sacrament of penance. Martin is pictured with a halo above his head. The people kiss these pictures. Such a quantity has been sold that I am unable to obtain one. I cannot go into the streets, but the Germans put their heads to their swords and gnash their teeth at me. Now, what had started as a simple debate over church practices was quickly becoming an open challenge to papal authority. The Habsburg Emperor Charles V, needing church support to rule his empire, feared this religious turmoil would spill over into political turmoil. Therefore, although religiously tolerant by the day's standards, Charles felt he had to deal with this upset monk. Now, a council of German princes, the Diet of Worms, was called in 1521. At this council, the German princes, opposed to the growth of imperial power at their expense, applauded Luther in his efforts. As a result, Charles had to summon Luther to the Diet so he could defend himself. Now, Luther's friends, remembering Jan Hus's fate, feared treachery and urged him not to go, but Luther was determined to go, though there were as many devils and worms as there are tiles on the roofs, according to Martin Luther. His trip to Worms was like a triumphal parade, as crowds of people came out to see him. Then came the climactic meeting between the emperor and the obscure monk. Luther walked into an assembly, packed to the rafters, with people sensing history in the making. A papal envoy stood next to a table loaded with Luther's writings and asked if he would take back what he had said. And Luther replied, "Unless I am convinced by the evidence of Scripture or by plain reason, for I do not accept the authority of the Pope or the councils alone, since it is established that they have often erred and contradicted themselves, I am bound by the Scriptures I have cited, and my conscience is captive to the Word of God. I cannot and will not recant anything, for it is neither safe nor right to go against conscience. God help me. Amen." Now, having defied church and empire, Luther was hurried out of town, where he was ambushed by his protector, Frederick of Saxony, and hidden in Wartburg Castle to keep him out of harm's way. However, although Luther dropped out of sight for a year, the Reformation did not go away. Now, because of his criticism of papal authority and church practices, Luther had been excommunicated from the church. This, along with the dramatic meeting at Worms, led him to make a final break with the Catholic Church and form Lutheranism, the first of the Protestant faiths. Now, this was not a new religion. It had basically the same beliefs about God as the Catholic faith. However, there were four main beliefs in the Lutheran faith that differed substantially from Catholicism. First, faith alone can gain salvation. No amount of good works can make any difference because man is so lowly compared to God. And in the Catholic faith, penance and good works are important to salvation. Second, religious truth is authority, and authority lie only in the Word of God, revealed in the Bible, not in any visible institutions of the Church. Now, this largely reflects what Wycliffe had said about the many institutions and rituals the Church valued, and as a result, Lutheranism tended to be simpler in practice than Catholicism. Third, the Church is the community of all believers, and there is no real difference between priest and layman in the eyes of God. The Catholic Church gave greater status to the clergy who devoted their lives to God. And fourth, the essence of Christian living lies in serving God in one's own calling. In other words, all useful occupations, not just the priesthood, are valuable in God's eyes. This especially appealed to the rising middle class, whose concern for money was seen as somewhat unethical by the medieval church. Now, when the church burned 300 copies of Huss's and Wycliffe's writings in the early 1400s, this dealt a heavy blow to the Hussite movement. However, from the start of the Reformation, printed copies of Luther's writings were spread far and wide in such numbers that the movement could not be contained. By 1524, there were 990 different books in print in Germany. 80% of those were by Luther and his followers, with some 100,000 copies of his German translation of the Bible in circulation by his death. Now, comparing that number to the 300 copies of Hussite writings underscores the decisive role of the printing press in the Protestant Reformation. Now, when discussing whom in society went Lutheran or stayed Catholic and why, various economic and political factors were important, but the single most important factor in one's decision was religious conviction. This was still an age of faith, and we today must be careful not to downplay that factor. However, other factors did influence various groups in the faith they adopted. Now, many German princes saw adopting Lutheranism as an opportunity to increase their own power by confiscating church lands and wealth. Many middle-class businessmen, as stated already, felt the Lutheran faith justified their activities as more worthwhile in the eyes of God. The lower classes at times adopted one faith as a form of protest against the ruling classes, and as a result, nobles tended to be suspicious of the spread of Protestant faith as a form of social and political rebellion. Many Germans also saw Lutheranism as a reaction against the Italian-controlled church that drained so much money from Germany. However, many German people remained Catholic despite any material advantages Lutheranism might bestow. Now, for both Catholics and Protestants, faith was still the primary consideration in the religion they adopted. Now, Lutheranism did not win over all of Germany, let alone all of Europe. Within Germany, Lutherans were the strongest in the north, while the south largely remained Catholic. However, Germany's central location helped Protestants spread their doctrine from northern Germany to Scandinavia, England, and the Netherlands. Now, although Luther had not originally intended to break with the church or break with Rome, once it was done, he tried to keep religious movement from straying from its true path of righteousness. Therefore, he came out of hiding to denounce new, more radical preachers. He also made the controversial stand of supporting the German princes against a major peasant revolt in Germany in 1525, since he saw the German princes' support as vital to the Reformation's survival. Now, this opened Luther to attacks by more radical Protestants who saw him as too conservative, labeling him the Wittenberg Pope. However, As the Protestant movement grew and spread, it became increasingly harder for Luther to control. Now, Martin Luther died February 18, 1546, at the age of 63. By this time, events had gotten largely out of his control and were taking violent and radical turns that Luther never could have liked, would have liked. Excuse me. Now, ironically, Luther, who had started this career with such a tortured soul and unleashed such a disruptive forces on Europe, died quite at peace with God and himself. Now, like so many great men, he was both a part of his times and the head of those times, thus serving as a bridge to the future. And he went to the grave with many old medieval Christian beliefs. However, his ideas shattered Christian unity in Western Europe, opening the way for new visions and ideas in such areas as capitalism, democracy, and science that shape our civilization today. And this is the end of this lecture. There will be other lectures posted that include a discussion of Calvinism, as well as Anabaptism and Zwinglism later. So again, this is History 105, and thank you for listening.